note, so thank you. And making this evening and this series possible, I want to call out again and thank Don and Brenda Mallett for their very generous underwriting and their support through all the years of the lecture series. They invited folks to step up and make a donation as well, and many of you have done that. Thank you so much. It keeps our program going. And like them, make a donation to any program that matters to you. Thank you, Don and Brenda. Bless you. You are an inspiration all the time to all of us. So with that, I want to begin our program. We have a very exciting conversation to come. So with that, I would like to introduce Pastor Amy Roon and invite Pastors Traci and Kelle to come online. And I will turn the program over to Pastor Amy, who will introduce these two wonderful folks and then also lead us into prayer as we start. Thank you.
Betty, one of the things I can't fail to do before we even get started with that, though, is to thank Betty Spieth-Kroll and this lecture series committee for putting this together for all of us on behalf of our congregation, but also on behalf of our regional congregations that delight in this series. And right now, of course, wherever you are in the world, you're participating. Thank you, Betty, and the lecture series committee. As Betty mentioned earlier, I want to encourage you to go ahead and, as the evening progresses, to go ahead and put your questions up as they come to you. I will be going through them, and if I need to check with you on exactly what the comment or the question is, and we'll be sorting that out. Hopefully that will help our question and answer time go a little bit more smoothly. Well, we have, I have wonderful notes here, and I'm just going to read them because otherwise I could go on about these two women all night long, and then you won't even hear from them, therefore not really doing my job. So, the Reverend Traci Blackman is the Executive Minister of Justice and Local Church Ministries for the United Church of Christ and Senior Pastor of Christ the King United Church of Christ in Florissant, Missouri. As a featured voice on regional, national, and international platforms, Reverend Blackman's life of discipleship focuses on communal resistance to systemic injustice. Her response to Ferguson, to the killing of Michael Brown, resulted in national and international recognition, gaining her many audiences spanning the breadth of the White House to the Carter Center to the Vatican. Her work is now featured in several Ferguson Uprising documentaries, appointed to the Ferguson Commission by Governor Jay Nixon, and to the President's Advisory Council on Faith-Based Neighborhood Partnerships for the White House by President Barack Obama. Reverend Blackman is a recipient of the NAACP Rosa Parks Award, the Urban League of St. Louis Women in Leadership Award, and the National Planned Parenthood Faith Leader Award, to name a few. Reverend Blackman is listed on Ebony Magazine's list of one of the 2015 Power 100. She is a featured writer in several publications. Reverend Blackman pledged Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated New Delta Chapter on the campus of Birmingham Southern College in 1981 and is currently active with the, I'm gonna get this wrong, Omicron? Is that how you say that? Omicron, they didn't have Greek organizations at Oberlin, so, you know, I'm working with it. Theta Omega Chapter in St. Louis, Missouri. She is a graduate of Leadership St. Louis and currently serves on the board of the Samuel DeWitt Proctor Conference and the editorial board of the St. Louis American. Reverend Blackman was named 2017 Citizen of the Year by the St. Louis American and as one of St. Louis's 100 most influential voices. The Center for American Progress has named Reverend Blackman as one of the 15 faith leaders to watch in 2020. Reverend Blackman currently resides in both St. Louis, Missouri and Cleveland, Ohio, and is the proud mother of three adult children, Courtney Devon, Harold II, and Tyler Wayne Blackman. Reverend Blackman, we are so thrilled to have you here. And I would also be remiss in forgetting to mention that I get to share this time and with all of you as well, because Catherine Foote is out on Whidbey with a power outage. Otherwise, we had to duke it out for this honor. I am also thrilled to introduce, if it's for the first time, to welcome her as colleague and friend, lead pastor at Plymouth Church, the Reverend Dr. Kelle Brown, who follows the Brown Palestinian revolutionary Jesus and is working for the reformation of the church, the movement that will save us from ourselves and our lust for power in the face of untended injustice. Amen. I am thrilled to hand this over to both of you. First to Traci, we will hear from you, and then Pastor Kelle will come on and share some conversation with you while I manage the chat. I am thrilled to hand this over to you, wonderful, wonderful women.
Thank you so much, Pastor Amy, and it is my delight to be here with both you and Pastor Kelle tonight. And to those who are listening, thank you for this invitation, this gracious invitation, which is much needed at this time in our nation's history. When I accepted this invitation, the question was, what brings me deep sorrow and what brings me deep joy? And as I reflected on those things for tonight, I have to tell you a story to get there so that you understand my response to these things. If you don't mind, I'd just like to be me tonight. I don't want to read to you or lecture you from preparation, but just to speak from my heart. What brings me deep sorrow in this moment is the state of our country. We have just finished an historic election in that more people came out to vote than we have seen in quite a while. And our electoral process is intact and working the way that it should work. People's votes were counted, and that count delayed our results for some days, but it was worth the wait for everyone's voice to be heard. In the course of this election, though, we are experiencing such dissonance and such division and such dismissal of one another that I find myself asking the question, how will we repair the breach? And how will we restore the streets that we are to dwell in? And my source of pain and grief and sorrow around this is not political, because I do not hold an opinion that God is either Republican nor Democrat, that God is partisan in his care or her care for us. My deep pain and sorrow is rooted in what I am seeing from those who profess to be people of faith on all sides of this argument in ways that we cannot find our way to have civil discourse with one another, to unite on things that we can unite on, and to forge our way through on things that we can't, to acknowledge and respect the human dignity and the divine presence that is in every living being. I am deeply concerned about who we are. And as I look back over just my life and history, I can see this moment coming again and again and again. I'm 57 years old. I am a child of the 60s, born in 1963. I am from Birmingham, Alabama, and was raised in Birmingham, Alabama until I became an adult and married and moved to Missouri. From an early age in Birmingham, Alabama, I was involved in freedom movement work without even knowing I was involved in freedom movement work. Born in 63, I was still a very young child during the time of the marches, during the time of the 16th Street bombing But I had parents and I had family. And as I grew and began to know what was happening and knew that people I called aunts and uncles and friends of the family were actually leaders and supporters in this movement. One of the children who was killed in 16th Street Baptist Church was the daughter of the man who eventually became the photographer for my wedding. And certainly I was friends with her sister as we matriculated through school for a while. Even during that time in Birmingham, Alabama, Black people lived with Black people in a segregated situation, and white people lived with white people in a segregated situation. But I was born at a unique time. I was born during a time that by the time I got into elementary school, the integration had taken place, and people were beginning to at least have the opportunity to get an equitable education by integrating schools in Birmingham. For me, that meant that I ended up leaving a Catholic school that was predominantly Black students, all Black students, but many of the priests and nuns were white at that time. And the secular teachers tended to be Black women. In my neighborhood, because we all lived in segregated areas, I'm not a person who thought that that was necessarily bad, because I grew up with Black people who were my heroes and who were my role models. My kindergarten teacher was my next door neighbor, and my dentist lived up the street. My orthodontist was around the corner. The first Black senator was two streets over. And then those who had blue collar jobs also lived in the neighborhood. We all lived together. We took care of one another. It was a village. And many of us went to school together. We either went to the public school that was on the corner, or we went to the Catholic school that was a little farther away that we had to drive to. And Mrs. Hill, who was my kindergarten teacher and next door neighbor, would gather the kids who were going to the Catholic school where she taught kindergarten, and she would take us to school every day, and she would bring us home every evening. And this was our ritual, and this was our village. And when we would come home, and perhaps we were in grades where we needed to do some extra work, or we had extra assignments and our parents were still working, Mrs. Hill would take us to her home, and there she would help us with our homework, and there she would make sure we knew everything we were supposed to know. So she knew us very well. By the time I got to third grade, I came from a family where my father read to me every night. I went to school knowing how to spell my name and knowing how to count, some things that many kids don't go to school knowing. And by third grade, it appeared to Mrs. Hill that I was being used to help other kids learn and not being challenged the way I should be myself. And so she recommended to my parents that they move me to another school. I was not in that conversation. I did not know that that was going to happen before it happened. It was summertime, and when it got close to time to go to school, I asked my mom when we were going to get my uniforms for the year, and she said, "Oh, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it." During the summer, she had asked me to take a test at this school, and she said, "I just want them to see how smart you are. I just want them to know how smart you are. I'm a competitive child." And so I took this test and never heard anything else about it, actually, until school was to start. And the very first day of school, I got ready and asked for my uniform. And my mom said, "You don't have to wear it today. You get to wear these new clothes." And she bought me a new outfit, and I put it on. And then I asked, "Well, is it time to go to Mrs. Hill's house so I can go to school?" And she said, "No, you're not going with Mrs. Hill today. I'm going to take you to school." And my mom took me to a brand new school on the other side of town that she had not told me that I was going to attend, that my father had not told me that I was going to attend. And when we got to the school, there was a safety patrol outside, there was a carpool, all of this was new to me. She stopped the car and she pointed in the back seat of the car and she said, "There are your books. This is your new school. Have a great day. She didn't walk me to class. She went on to her job, and I got out of the car a little frightened and a little timid because I really didn't know what had happened. I was directed to the fourth grade class by strangers who were in the halls of the school and strangers who were in safety patrol, none of whom looked like me. And when I got to the fourth grade class, I realized that everyone in the class was white, including the teacher. And it was my first cognizant remembrance of knowing that I was Black. Students began to ask me what color blood did I have and could they touch my hair? Questions that seemed cruel, but were not coming from a cruel place. For you see, not only was this my experience, my first experience in a class that had no one who looked like me, it was their first experience in a class with someone who did not look like them. My time at this private Episcopal school was littered with opportunities to grow into this new reality. I remember that it was rough when I first started, that there was this bully in class who would call me all kind of names. And I remember once him calling me a nigger. It was the first time I'd heard that word and I didn't know what it meant, but by the way it came out of his mouth, I knew it was something that I didn't want to be. I reached deep inside of myself, even as a fourth grader, and tried to remember something that I had heard my father say when he was angry when he came home from work. It didn't have much definitive meaning to me, but I wanted this little boy to feel the hurt I felt when he said that word. And so I called him a peck of wood, because that's the word that my father had taught me. Why do I share this story with you? Because at a very early age, children begin to mimic the behaviors that they see. That experience in fourth grade for me, and I could tell you many stories about it, opened my eyes in ways that they had not been opened before. And as I progressed through my educational time, my eyes were opened again and again, because for the rest of my elementary school, my high school, I never was in a class with anyone who looked like me. It wasn't until I went to college that I had the opportunity to be in another class with someone that was Black. And it wasn't until seminary that I was taught by another Black teacher after third grade. I had a very strong village, and that village provided balance and equity for me in ways that helped me not to lose myself. But during that journey, my friends, I saw things and I heard things and I found myself in places that allowed me to see the underbelly of this nation, this underbelly of our communities, the distress, the distrust, the fear, the categorization of people from all sides. And I bring that to the grief that I feel in this election. Because over and over and over again, we have failed to confront and failed to deal with the deep divisions that we have in this country that have been caused by race, by racism. So here we are in 2020, in an election that has divided our country. That whether you are Republican or whether you are Democrat, you find yourself on opposite sides of an aisle that seems to have no bridge across. And as I look at the results of the election, though media would have us to think, and perhaps it's comforting for us to think, that the majority of people who are divided on these issues are theologically divided as well, are white evangelicals versus progressives, whether they are white or black, but the voting data from this election just does not bear that out. 61% of Protestants voted Republican in this election. 50% of Catholics voted Republican in this election. 71% of Mormons voted Republican in this election. 57% of those who identify as Christian but don't identify in any of those categories voted Republican in this election. And I suspect that much of this vote was for the pro-life agenda. I suspect that that is much of the reason that people gave for being this divided. But I'm baffled and I'm deeply sorrowful that that pro-life agenda did not extend to the 278,000 people who have lost their lives to COVID, a pandemic that this administration has denied even existed at first, and now has declared to be over, in spite of the fact that we have now had over 100,000 people a day becoming infected. We have the state of Texas, which has topped over 1 million cases. I'm baffled that this case for life does not include the lives of 592 children who are still separated from their families at the borders in this country. I'm baffled that that case for life does not include 13.9 million children who go to bed hungry every night in a country that has more than enough. I am baffled that this stance and this vote for life does not include all of creation, and that there seems to be no concern about the wildlife that are dying in our forest fires, many of which are on federal property but are not being tended to, or the women caged at the border who have been involuntarily sterilized over these last 3 years, or the constant and consistent lies designed to continue a history of criminalizing Blackness and militarizing police, placing thousands of lives in danger repeatedly. I am baffled by those of us who profess to follow a Palestinian Jew named Jesus, whose followership of Jesus, who himself was a stranger sheltered in a foreign land, voted against welcoming the stranger among us. Or the wildlife that continues to die in forest fires, many of which, as I said, are on federal land. I am baffled that Christians who profess to follow Jesus overwhelmingly voted for an administration that has not done anything to feed the hungry, who has refused to pass another stimulus package during a pandemic that has ravaged our country, who has not done anything to aggressively protect the healthcare and the well-being of people, not even by sustaining the Affordable Care Act or by presenting a substantive alternative. I'm baffled by those who support an administration that has failed to clothe the naked or care for the widows. And let me be clear here. Given that 90% of the Black vote in this election was against the current president, I am talking about the white Christian vote. And it gives me deep sorrow that not only are we divided into red and blue, but this election has shown how deeply we are divided into white and non-white, Black and brown. I recall my deep awareness of this in Charlottesville. In 2017, I was asked to come to Charlottesville because of my work in Ferguson. And originally I said I would not go to Charlottesville because I felt that the problems of every community need to be handled and led by the people of that community. I feel that deeply. And I denied the need for me to be there. The organizers for the counter-protest for the alt-right rally that was scheduled for Charlottesville called me again and said, "We understand, we're not asking you to come to lead anything. We just want you to give words of hope before we go out into the streets on Saturday. We're asking you to preach on Friday night, to encourage us, to strengthen us. And we've also asked Dr. Cornell West to come." So I said yes, and I traveled to Charlottesville. In time the plane landed and I got into the city, I knew that something was different. There was security all around the hotels. People were worried about our safety in ways that I had not even experienced in Ferguson. Something was different. I got in time to take a shower and to prepare for worship that night. Greeted friends that I saw in the lobby. We were all staying in the same hotel. And we traveled to the church in caravans with drivers taking us there for the most part. When we arrived at the church was filled, packed to the rafters. People were all around the walls. It was an interfaith service, and an interfaith service it definitely was. There were cantors, there were readings from Islamic readers, there were Sikh people who spoke there as well. There were Christians, yes, but everyone's worship was welcomed. And it was a wonderful service. I preached in that service about David and Goliath and the fascination we have with naming ourselves as David and never recognizing the potential of Goliath in all of us. I said in that service that there's one little line in the story of David and Goliath that we don't often tell. And when we're telling that story, we describe Goliath, but there's a line about Goliath that gets glossed over. And it is the line that says he comes from among the Philistines. And that line is important, my friends, because the Philistines are the village from which Goliath was raised. And how we are raised and what we are taught and what we are fed and what we see impacts who we become. I talked about that night. And I talked about those of us who fight for justice and liberation often celebrate too soon. I talked about how we preach about David knocking down Goliath with the stone and the slingshot. Indeed, we say he killed Goliath that way. And the text even says he killed Goliath that way. But then the text goes on to say that after he had knocked him down, David went over to Goliath and he took Goliath's sword and he cut his head off. As violent and as brutal as that may seem, it is this action that causes the Philistine army to dissipate. And while I don't suggest that we should be violent, I don't suggest that. I'm not suggesting that we should take another's life because we should not, and I don't suggest that. I am suggesting that we must become a people that stops celebrating too soon. That we gain joy and we gain strength from winning the battles, but that we recognize there is still a war. And that until we get to that place, we will not be able to make the changes that this country, indeed this world, really needs. Having finished that sermon and finished a delightful and wonderful and energizing worship, I was preparing to do the benediction when someone whispered in my ear, "You can't do the benediction, start singing." We began singing song after song after song. I'm waiting for a clue that we can conclude the service. I'm wondering what's going on. No one is telling me. And so I keep singing until I'm tired of singing. And I call the person over and they say, "You can't stop the service because the building is surrounded by alt-right people. The building is surrounded. The church is surrounded." I've come to know now that it wasn't so much that they were surrounding the church as they were filling the streets. You see, the alt-right rally was coming to Charlottesville in the midst of the debates about taking down Confederate statues, and they were there to preserve and protect the statue that was at the university across the street. And in their zeal and their zest to do that, they showed up on Friday night in hundreds and hundreds and hundreds, maybe even thousands of them, showed up on Friday nights, and there was too many of them not to have the church surrounded. I'm not certain that they knew exactly what was going on in the church, but they knew that we were having some kind of rally. We were told that we could not go out of the building. We could not leave the building for fear of our lives. And in that moment, my friends, I gained great courage because of that story I told you of being raised in Birmingham, Alabama. I'd watched Klan rallies as a little child. I'd seen them parade down the street in white sheets and pointy hats. And even as a little child, I thought that looked ridiculous. I had no fear of the Klan because I did not experience them as burning crosses in my yard or threatening me personally. And whenever I saw them, I was with adults that made me feel safe. So I did not have the fear of it, but I had the experience of it. I decided that no one would make me go out of a back door. No one would make me go out of a side door. I came in the front door and I was leaving out of the front door. Much to the protest of security who was all around us. Dr. Cornell West was with me and he said, "Yes, sister, we'll both go out of the front door." Well, I opened that door and as far as I could see, I saw nothing but tiki torches. I didn't know they were tiki torches at the time. I just saw the fire. Later, as we drove through that crowd, I recognized that they were tiki torches. Masses and masses of white faces, young white faces, and the sheets were gone. There were no hoods. There was no hiding. Mostly young white faces that looked like they could be the friends of my children, the classmates of my children, people who I work with. And in that moment, I became terribly afraid because many realizations converged upon me at one time. I recognized in that moment that what I had always based my hope on was that white supremacy, Black hatred would die. that the generations who had been so antagonistic to equity, to peace, to justice, would die, and that the younger generations would be different. And in that moment, I realized that that would not be the case. That if we were ever to clear ourselves of racism and hatred and injustice and bitterness, that we would have to kill it. We would have to cut its head off. From that moment to this moment, my friends, I have not been able to watch a news show or a TV show or newspaper picture even of Charlottesville for fear I might see someone that I know. And I also realized that those sheets and those hats had not just protected the identity of those who wore them, but they had protected me. They had allowed me not to face the reality that those people who were behind the sheets and behind the hoods might be people that I know. And here we are now in 2020, facing this reality again, in a nation that is in the midst of a pandemic, in a nation where our economy is struggling, in a nation where we need one another more than ever. And the results of this election have not just chosen a new president, but have revealed a deep divide that still exists in these yet to be United States of America. A racial divide that has been emboldened and emblazoned, not just in these past 3.5 years, but one that began to sprout as we watched the first Black president spend 2 terms fighting against a birther narrative that everyone knew was not true. Spend the final term being hamstrung by a Senate who refused to work with him and fought him on every hand. We watched a 2016 election that was riddled with lies and bitterness and hateful rhetoric. And we allowed ourselves as the church to be divided over our differences in theology, our differences in doctrine, our differences in dogma, to such a degree that we could not even acknowledge the commonness we have in the breath of God. So when I think about what gives me deep sorrow, it is these things that do so. And yet, I find joy in knowing that in spite of this moment, there is still hope. There is still the opportunity for us to make our way back to one another. There is still faith. There are still those things and principles that calls us together as one nation under God. I was reminded of this as a pastor long ago in Ferguson, when Michael Brown died and I found myself overnight in a new role as pastor to a community. That role required me to be out in the streets when young people were in the streets, to take shifts with other clergy who were committed to that same cause, to stand up and support and defend the right to protest while not losing sight of the humanity of those who were being militarized against us. It reminded me of that moment when I came to church to preach one Sunday, and Sandy, one of my older members who happened to be a white member who was in her 80s and had lived in a nursing home and had become a member of our church because it was in the community of her nursing home, and whom we had helped get an apartment when she felt strong enough not to be in the nursing home anymore and helped her furnish it, and who was very much active and engaged and an integral part of our body. She came to church one Sunday and came into my study before worship. And she said, "Pastor, I have an announcement to make during announcements. Will you call on me?" And I said, "Certainly." I forgot to call on Sandy because Sandy was often guilty of giving an announcement that was longer than my sermon. She reminded me and boldly stood up and said, "I told you I have an announcement." I said, "I'm sorry, Sandy." She asked me to come down from the pulpit and stand on the floor with her, and I did. This 80-year-old woman came out of the pew dragging a grocery cart, one of those wire carts like you take when you're walking to the grocery store, and all I could see was plastic and different color yarn. It was October of 2014. And every October we had a coat giveaway. We'd give away 100 coats free of charge, new coats to whoever needed them in the neighborhoods. And Sandy was there that Sunday carrying this grocery cart in the church with all of this yarn. I didn't know what she had done. She came up to where I was and she said, "Pastor, I'm so very proud of you. Every time I see you in the street, I'm proud of you. Every time I read about it, I'm proud of you. And if I were younger, I would be out there right with you, standing by your side. But I'm not young anymore. I can't do what I used to do. But I wanted to do something. So I remembered when I was in the nursing home that my roommate taught me how to crochet. And I went and found my crochet needles and I bought all this yarn. And all month I have been crocheting. I've made 100 hats and 100 scarves to go with our coats for our coat giveaway." And she packaged each plastic bag with a hat and a scarf and a little handwritten note that said, "No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here at Christ the King." She told me that when she worked as a young person, she was a teacher, a math teacher. And she said, "I can't get out in the streets, but I counted every stitch as I crocheted. And I figure, Pastor, that I have marched 5 miles with my hands. And even today, my friends, when I need hope, and when I need joy, and when I need strength, I think about Sandy. And I'm reminded that even though the roots of racism and hatred and bitterness run deep in this country, that they have never been and never will be all the roots that they are, that there are. And there is fruit that grows on every tree, of every race, of every color, of every gender expression, of every sexuality, across all spectrums. There are those who are growing and blossoming and who mean hope and who mean love and who mean justice can prevail if we simply stop to see. Thank you.
Reverend Traci Blackman, friends, I am so grateful. And this goes back to my Black sacred tradition, did not our hearts burn? Because you preached to us tonight. Reverend Blackman, I'm so grateful just for the few moments for us to be in conversation. You left us with hope, and I am so grateful to you tonight.
Thank you, Pastor Kelle. You have to buzz in because I get going and I just keep
listening. Listen. I'm over here. I'm just listening. I was going to let you go. So no worries. I thank you for this time together. I want to just give you a moment to breathe, because I know that when you pour out like that, you need a moment. So I want to just thank you for sharing the story of Sandy and for really your truth telling and your courage, because this is the season where I'm finding that as people of faith, particularly as Christians, we are called to be courageous, to tell the truth, to stop assuming that being nice is being faithful. Mm-hmm. And to truly understand what's at stake here. So thank you so much for what you have brought to us tonight. And I just want to pick up on something that was so hot to me. And that was the concept you brought up of, we are celebrating too soon. Our joy was extended. It most certainly was a Good Friday Easter moment, right? Because we had to wait several days for the election results to come in. But of course, I watched you and I watched so many others on Facebook and other social media places where people were so exhausted because they were Googling 2020 election results and just waiting for the numbers to come in. And many of us were, rending our cloth and, and sitting in ashes because we didn't know which way it was, but it would go. But now here we are, many of us are celebrating. I would love for you to share with us again, you have done so well, but just share what's at stake when we celebrate too soon, because I am afraid that our muscles are atrophied for the work that must happen going forward. So please just
briefly help us. Say it like this. I have a clock that plays music every hour in my house. So if that's the music that you hear, maybe you don't hear it. I hope you don't. The victory of this election was hard won, and we deserve some joy and celebration about that. But the reality is 70 million people did not vote for this victory. Mm-hmm. And because of the way that there is no healing force, no gathering force mm-hmm. in this country around this, the fact, the reality is, and I won't name cities because that's just alarmist, but mm-hmm. I'm in conversations now about cities that have to be monitored for attacks, mm-hmm. for vigilante justice, for denial of this election return. And so while we must celebrate, we must not be comfortable in that celebration, because mm-hmm. we have to stay on the wall. And that's just one part of it. Mm-hmm. The other part of it is, no matter who sits in the White House, the prophet must speak.
That's right.
So we needed a change in our administration, but that change does not equate to justice for us.
That's right.
And so it doesn't really matter whether it's blue or whether it's red, whether it's black or whether it's white or whether it's brown, whether it's a woman or whether it's man, when you sit in the emperor's seat, you are the emperor, and the prophet must always speak against the emperor. So I watch historically how we made all these strides during the freedom movement of the 60s through the 70s, and we gained the right to vote, and we celebrated. And yep. Here we are fighting for the right to vote again, right?
That's right.
To integrate schools, and we celebrate it. And here we are fighting for the educational equity of our children.
Right.
Gain the right to have, to be in anybody's educational institutions. And now here we are fighting for the sustainability of our own institutions.
That's right. So what is it? What is it? Reverend Blackman, is it the sort of general assumption that we deserve joy? Is it the, our love of comfort? What is it?
It's an assumption that things are equitable because a few are doing well. It's the assumption of a story that would suggest to us that because a minority of people are doing well. And let me be clear, that minority is black and white, right? Mm-hmm. When we talk about white supremacy, when we talk about white privilege, there's a certain amount of privilege that comes with white skin. But being white does not save you. And no. When we talk about the power structure of whiteness, we're not even talking about all white people. Right? And so this system works because we have bought into a system that allows us to be diminished just to the color of our skin. Mm-hmm. And when we find escapes that make us closer to what it is we think is the thing to be, then we lose our continuity and our connection with all the people who are like us, the 99%, right? Mm-hmm. And we celebrate those glimpses. We celebrate that we can move to a better neighborhood. We celebrate that we have a stable job. We forget that we are all connected. And because we forget, we continue to repeat this over and over again. It's no different than scripture. It's no different than scripture, right? Mm-hmm. And so I say we celebrate too soon, not because we don't deserve joy, but because there is work on the other side of that joy. And we cannot sit in our laurels and think we have, this is not going to be popular, but we did that with Barack Obama.
That's right.
Right?
That's right.
We did that and with Barack Obama.
Let's be honest. So here we are, you're in the Pacific Northwest. We welcome you and we long for the day that you'll be here in person when it's safe and when you can come and be a part of our communities. But let's be honest, you are a part of that as well. The United Church of Christ, many of us are celebrating because we're post-racial in the appointment of Reverend Traci Blackman. We are post-racial in the appointment of Reverend Amy Roon, post-racial in the appointment, who is Amy Roon, who is one of the pastoral leaders in a predominantly white congregation. And I am the lead pastor also of a predominantly white congregation. So when I first was there, many people said I was their Obama. And, it's like our work here is done. All the anti-racism work we've done has been realized in you.
You got Obama, I got Martin Luther King.
Oh, there we go.
No, I'm not Martin Luther King. You're not about to get me killed up in
here. Oh, I know that's right. Stay off the balconies, please.
Oh, no. But the thing about that is the United Church of Christ is still 85% white.
That's right.
Right? In spite of our racial justice work, which has been significant and has been profound, mm-hmm. I believe God keeps you and you're only where you are because of God.
That's right.
It's also been externally facing.
Mm-hmm.
So we have our own work to do and we can't celebrate too soon.
That's right.
And now the national setting and the board of the United Church of Christ are launching into what will be they keep saying, how long is it going to be? It's going to be for the rest of our lives.
Right.
We're launching into this program to examine ourselves, where scripture says, create in me a clean heart.
Mm-hmm.
We must come to grips with and acknowledge our complicity.
That's right.
In the enslavement of African people, we must acknowledge that many of our endowments are money that was collected, including the assets gained from the free labor of Black people.
That's right.
We must acknowledge that many of the families connected with our churches, though maybe many were abolitionists in their hearts, also benefited and profited from the free labor of enslaved people.
Mm-hmm.
And what does it mean for us to live out our mantra of justice, racial justice, internally as well as externally?
Mm-hmm.
So for us, that's going to mean looking at our documents, looking at our policies, looking at our practices, looking at our praxis, looking at our interpretations of scripture.
Mm-hmm.
We have very progressive churches that dress up like pilgrims every year.
That's right. They are featured prominently at Plymouth Church, United Church of Christ, in stained glass.
That was not a planted thing. I didn't.
I know. We haven't spoken before. We know.
We have lots of progressive churches.
Mm-hmm.
That still depict the story of Mayflower coming and discovering land people were already living.
Right.
We have amnesia around the stories of our families.
That's right.
And let's be clear, when I talk about those Protestants, the 61% of Protestants who voted against the principles of Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
Forget the candidates.
That's right.
Both of them are flawed. I'm saying who voted against the principles of Jesus, they weren't all outside of the United Church of Christ.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
The United Church of Christ has a very progressive LGBTQ face.
Mm-hmm.
Yet less than 30 of our churches are open and affirming.
All right.
So we have our own wars still going on, and we can celebrate our victories, but we can't celebrate and forget that we're still in a war.
That's right.
That's what I'm saying.
Well, I think what you have lifted up for me, and I hope for those who are listening, is that actually the sorrow is well placed. Because I think ultimately we as people of faith and as Christians and however we see ourselves entering the conversation, many of us don't know lament. Our churches have totally forgotten how to do it well. Lent is really a preview for Easter. So it's sort of like an Advent, a preview for Christmas, right? You just run through the process enough to get to the home base. And so somehow this moment of sorrow is not about shame. For I lifted up what's happening at Plymouth, but I know it's happening at many of our churches and many places around the country. So it's not about shame, but this is a moment where we can do some work that Reverend Dr. Matthew Johnson, who actually is in Birmingham, Alabama right now, he wrote a book on the tragic vision of African American religion. And what he says is that we have to look at the horror and stop looking away from it in search of joy. Because if we do, we can meander through this sorrow and find ourselves at a place where we burst through to hope and to joy. Mm-hmm. And so you've said that so beautifully, and I'm grateful. I just wonder, what will it take for all of us in churches, because particularly for those who lead, the assumption is often, or sometimes, that the leaders will do the work. How can we invite folks to be a part of this work and to not languish in sorrow, but to work through it so that together we'll come out on the other side joyful.
Yeah. You know, one of the things I often talk about as I tour United Church of Christ churches in particular, because I think that the desire to be just and to be fair is there. That's an authentic desire. And oftentimes the question is asked, well, how do we build relationships with Black people? Well, how do we get more Black people to come to our churches? Well, how do blah, 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 blah. You know, I have thoughts about that have to do with reorienting our understanding of what it means to be church, mm-hmm. and reorienting our ownership of church, right? Mm-hmm. And so the only place that it matters how many colors you have in a place is at Crayola.
Come on.
It's not about
how many colors
you have in a place, right? It's about not only you changing the physical vision of the place you worship in, but you being transformed by the stories and the culture and the history of those who worship together in that place. That you began to see not just skin color, but people.
That's right.
And not just other skin color, but also your humanity, which has been diminished by, all of us are diminished when we are only seen by the color of our skin, right? Mm-hmm. And so when people say, how do I get more diversity in my church?
Yeah.
The question is always, what does your life look like?
That's right.
What do your friends look like? Mm-hmm. Because you can have lots of diversity in your church and not know anything about those people outside of the 2 hours that you worship together.
So right.
When we build churches that are beloved community, it won't be just about skin color. Mm-hmm. And the church will be changed by everyone who enters. I think that's important.
That's right. Thank you for telling the truth around that and for sending us in a generative and authentic way. Because I tell my church, and I will say it wherever I'm blessed to speak, that this work needs to happen, whether there's a person of a Black, brown, or indigenous person in your church or not. The work of dismantling white supremacy, of speaking to the anti-Blackness that's so implicit in the way that we do theology and hermeneutics, the ways that we often engage a conversation, that needs to happen whether Black folks or brown folks or indigenous folks are there or not. And as a matter of fact, when we see clergy of color leaving these churches, unfortunately, often I say perhaps that work needs to happen before so that you won't harm the people who dare to be a part of you. And so, you know, please.
No, I was listening. I was just, amen.
Yeah. And so, I just want to thank you so much for this moment and this time, because we need the truth telling, as many of us are doing the reading together of books. We're doing James Baldwin, of course, and others at Plymouth Church, and the work that University Congregational has been doing to understand who it is, daring to put banners on our buildings that say Black Lives Matter, and even further to have things that represent that in terms of what we're doing within the church. Mm-hmm. This is this will be many years before we are close to embarking on a reality that will actually be equitable. But your words tonight in who you are and what you bring. The story, your vulnerability and the stories of growing up in Birmingham. I grew up in Columbus, Georgia, so I came from,
I know very well,
you know, as a child who was in one of the first integrated classes, and I was born in 72. So I know very well. My best friend across the street who called me the N-word, and I basically did my version of a cuss out. I didn't have many words at that time when I was about 5 or 6, but I fussed her out and I said, all right, I'll see you tomorrow. Because I couldn't imagine not being with my friend. So I thank you.
But there's joy in that. Right?
There's so much joy.
I want to leave people with this transparency. I see Amy, so I know we're out of town.
That's right.
You know.
Well, actually, it's time to shift to a couple other things. You got a little bit more time left, but, you know, I'm just here to nudge you in another direction.
I'll say this in a nutshell. One of the places that I had to be uprooted and replanted was around my understanding of sexuality. Mm-hmm. I grew up in Pentecostal Southern Baptist backgrounds. Mm-hmm. I was not taught to affirm God in every human being. Mm-hmm. I was not taught that. But as I grew up and formed relationships with people who were same gender loving, mm-hmm. and those people became a part of my life, then I recognized that what I had been taught was a lie.
That's right.
And I came to that realization out of that relationship. As I matured in that realization, it was like scales falling off my eyes. And I was so excited about every little thing I had learned, every little thing I read. And I had a good friend whose name was Rudy, and he was same gender loving, and we were very close. And every time I would read something or figure something out, I would call Rudy. Every time I had a question, I would call Rudy. Every time I wanted to know something, even if it wasn't my business, I would call Rudy. One night I called Rudy one too many times. And Rudy said to me, Traci, I love you. And I'm glad that you have been awakened. And I'm glad you get it. But your need to know does not create in me a need to educate.
Amen. Go
get you a book.
That's right. Google it.
Stop calling me, asking me to teach you mm-hmm. about gay people. Mm-hmm. That has stuck with me. Mm-hmm. And I offer it in this space because if you want to know, get you some books.
That's right.
Go see some movies. Read some articles. And yeah. then bring what's left for a dialogue. Mm-hmm. But yeah. we are no longer in an age where Black people want to educate in that way.
Mm-hmm. Or should.
Brown people want to educate in that way. Where any marginalized people want to be the tutor. Mm-hmm. Things that we have to do ourselves.
Right.
Okay, Amy.
Thank you so much.
I have like a couple of quick things. We're going to redirect. We're going to do the song as we go instead of, we usually have this pause for music, but from the folks that I'm hearing from too, they're like, no, just keep going. So we're going to keep going. We'll hear the music at the very end. I got to put a little something on that because I have to say, one, if we value teaching and we really think education is important and requires, that's great. I find that sometimes then when you're asking your Black friend or your gay friend to somehow educate you on something, you are not respecting, either pay them.
Well,
respect the work.
That.
right. But also, it's sometimes in an authentic relationship, it's
right.
also a way of saying, I don't believe you, I need to know more.
Mm-hmm.
And that is, that's its own challenge for me. And I say this also because, you know, I don't come from the South, as Kelle knows. I'm I am a biracial, transracial adoptee from Minnesota. Mm-hmm. So ironically, the older I get, the more complicated this gets in that I know white people really, really well. But
bicultural.
People don't immediately, I have to like have that on my resume or something. People don't immediately realize that. But it was my my scales were in then with my very white liberal parents who were teaching me and having in our life wonderful folks who are gay or lesbian and their partners and a part of our lives. And then to go to seminary and to and have these dialogues with my parents and discover that my mom still held to this theology that that was to that sort of love the sinner, hate the sin sort of thing. And I was appalled. I was just like, this is, do you not realize this is not what you taught me? And I feel like that's a whole, that to me has been another layer of both heterosexism and racism is they're the things we, there are things we teach our children and we talk about. And then when the system, it's just like you were given with that story where we didn't, it didn't end it. Mm-hmm. We didn't finish taking that apart. And so it be, it's that layer cracks. And I think particularly it's very disruptive and disappointing for our children. I know it was for me, for my, for that experience, but I already know I'm doing that. My son's 12. I'm sure I'm disappointing him daily. So I wanna name a couple things here in these last minutes. Some of the things that are happening in the Q&A, some are just that are saying thank you to both of you and just glad you could be there. And I'm gonna go back to the first one to put the question out there, and she's a former parishioner of mine over at United Churches of Olympia, that she would like to ask Reverend Blackman, if you think there is any way for today's police force to get free from the origins of policing and slave patrols. Just a little something as we close. We might have another question.
That's a whole lecture.
Yes.
The short answer is no.
Yeah.
Policing as we know it in this country must be dismantled, mm-hmm. and something must rise in its place. Mm-hmm. It is infected institutionally, historically, and systemically, and it cannot be saved. That's the short answer.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Thank you, Leslie. Leslie works, I've done work with her, and she is tremendously gifted in terms of working towards justice. So I thank her for that question. And thank you to Reverend Blackman for being so honest, because I think we keep lingering in the myth that somehow we can just break this down to the foundation and then build something on top. No. The whole thing needs to go.
There's a wonderful study. The lead author on its last name is Goff, G-O-F-F. And the name of the study is The Essence of Innocence. Mm-hmm. And you can Google it. It is a study that was done with a lot of different career groups. Police are just one, where they would show them images and have discussions with them about Black people and Black children. And even in that study of law enforcement as a group, it was detected that even as early as the age of 8, that Black children were seen by law enforcement officers, Black male children were seen by law enforcement officers as fully adult men. Mm-hmm. And the way you'd handle a man is not the way you handle a child.
That's right.
It is an explanation for the Tamir Rices of this
Tamir
world.
Tamir Rice, that's
it
right.
It is an explanation for the Emmett Teals of this world. Mm-hmm. It is an explanation for the Trayvon Martins of this
world. That's right.
And so what is inherent in this system that we have built, that started from slave catchers, will never be what we need to create community, to move people from an understanding that they are there to police rather than to protect Black communities. It plays out over and over again. It must be dismantled.
Yep. Amen. So here's another, just a little question that I see on here. Pastor Kelle spoke of white congregations needing to do work before bringing Black people into their spaces and harming them. Can you speak more about the ways harm is done and what work should be done in advance? And I will add to this, connect it to the other question that you started to address a little bit already, that, you know, how our predominantly white congregations can embrace diversity or have build trust or actually, you know, I hear that a lot, you know, it's not bring a Black person to church day. That's not what we're going to get to, but they feel a little bit connected. What's the work that needs to be done in advance for a diverse, for a community to handle diversity without doing harm? And what is that harm?
Are you asking Pastor Kelle or are you asking me?
It's not clear from the questioner, so I'd say to go to either of you.
Reverend Blackman, if you have something, please.
I'm just going to say a little bit, then I'm going to punt it over to you. To be white in America is to be the fish that lives in the water. The work, just to use that imagery, is for white people to be able to conceive what it's like to not live in that water. to be a fish out of water, right? It is a hard journey for white people because this country has been crafted for whiteness. Mm-hmm. And so the harm and the work is that if the water is created for you, then you live quite comfortably in it. But if you are not in the water and you are trying to survive in this world, it is extremely difficult. We need white people to get uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. We need white people to answer the question, honestly, what do I have to lose? Mm-hmm. And what am I willing to lose, mm-hmm, so that everyone can have what they need?
Mm-hmm. That's
I'm right. Going to let Pastor Kelle talk about it because it was something she brought up.
Well, and I thank you. Because the piece for me is that I have been in predominantly white congregation since I was 8, off and on. And one of the things that I know today is that there are people more concerned with someone calling them racist than being racist. And that's disturbing to me. It's more of an insult to be called racist than it is for someone to say, hey, this thing that happened, that let's discuss this, it was racist and it impacted me. Somehow there has to be the awareness that it is faithful to acknowledge when and to believe. You know, I want to say that folks who find themselves Black, Brown, Indigenous, and in leadership of predominantly white congregations are often not believed. And I want to say that we are the Gospel of John, that we are written and in your midst so that you might believe us. Because it does harm to us to have to continually say, well, it is harmful for you to touch my hair. It is harmful for you to say that I'm the angry Black woman if I get a little energetic when I preach. It is harmful, though, all of those things. And so having to describe and to define that over and over again, it's soul zapping. And it takes so much energy when we want to be doing things like putting on lecture series or bringing in folks like the Reverend Dr. Blackman. But much of our soul's work is often taken up in trying to describe the pain. So believe us, trust us. Trust leadership that doesn't look like the leadership you might get from a white male or a person who is white identified, and honor that though it may be different and you may not understand it or recognize it, it is still valuable leadership. So I'm grateful that many of you are doing the work, and I look forward to the moment that we can be joyful in this, but it is honoring for us to be honest about the reality of the hard work that we do.
Yeah. And emotional labor is real labor.
It's real.
We are, the work often of people of color within predominantly white settings that are trying and wanting to be more diverse is, there is an inordinate amount of emotional labor to negotiate and to navigate and lead. It's very hard to critique communities that are predominantly white on how to grow in diversity while you're experiencing folks who are, you know, how can I give honest criticism and not have that become personal, because people want to have some comfort from their pastor that we're doing okay, which I want to give them. And then sometimes I got to be like, well, we're not doing this. This is not going well. Like, how do we, you got to be both pastor and prophet in the same place. And honestly, one of those pieces is to take seriously the cost of emotional labor and not discount it, because that means that we will need to do some internal work or our own repair in order to be fully present. And that's a different way of understanding. There's a lot around understanding white supremacy culture that can be done in preparation for a person of color to be in a leadership role, in understanding how that can function.
So it is so hard for me to end this conversation. I have to be the bad guy here. And it's so hard to end the series because it's been four or five weeks of good conversation. Am I echoing? No, I hope not. But we have to end. And I want to just deeply say how grateful we are, Reverend Blackman, Reverend Brown, Reverend Roon. We are deeply grateful to all of you for, let me tell you one moment that stuck with me. There were so many, but one is the idea that is too soon to celebrate, when I think it's been 400 years since the original sin of this nation, and that is too soon to celebrate. It breaks my heart. As a white person, I have to sit in that for a while and take responsibility for that. So thank you for that little nugget and so many of the other ones. We do have to end. So thank you to our audience who have been with us tonight. There are questions left in the Q&A. I'm sorry we couldn't get to them all. We will be watching this again and again and learning from it. So we are deeply grateful for you. Jeff, we're going to see if we can go out with the wonderful music from the piece for us.
A quick prayer before we have, and then we'll have the music.
Yes, please pray us out.
Oh, so find yourself centered wherever you are, and remind your body that it is fully present in the grace and light of God right where you are. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your presence this evening and for your presence in our lives. We thank you for the way you move within the Reverend Blackman and Reverend Brown. We thank you for their words tonight. We thank you for this opportunity to gather, to become inspired, to bolster ourselves for the work ahead, and the trust in one another that we will do it together. And we will remember one another in the times of sorrow that we are not alone, and that in times of joy, we have friends and family to gather and celebrate. Amen.
Amen. Thank you all. Good night.
Thank you for having me. Thank you.
Come back when you can.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Jesus walked the sea.